Rickey, how did you keep your faith even with everything that you were enduring? Like your the way the movie depicted your dad, he wasn't exactly like, I don't think he, like the way I saw it, he wasn't like intentionally abusive, but he wanted you to do what he wanted you to do. I mean, can you just explain that?
I have explained this a lot about it. I basically asked for it myself because I wanted to do what he was doing. You see, you know how you want to follow your dad's footsteps? Well, I wanted to be a preacher
He
until
got too good at it at 8 years old.
And I started hitting rocks, and then I realized how good I was at that. And then so I have a combination here. I've got myself with my father wanting me to be a preacher because he sees me out there and I'm tearing it up in the pulpit. And then I also am grabbing rocks all day long and hitting rocks all day long as well. And then the rocks kind of took over the pulpit and I started hitting rocks just all from sun up till sundown. And hitting rocks with a stick. And so, I can see it. I kind of actually did that to my father because he's so thrilled to see his son out there beating his own dad at preaching. And I'm just such a young boy. And he loved it. And so he took heart at that and he loved it. And I love the fact that he loved it so much that he loved me no matter what. He always gave me the strength to make it through, even including even hitting the stick and hitting the rocks, and always was tender to me and loving and kind. And then eventually he let me make my own decision of what I wanted to do. He did.
Did he, is it accurate that in the movie that he didn't go to your games or
He never saw me play.
not even once?
Not even once.
So even in, he never in real life.
Never.
Wow. Why not?
He gave him.
Because see, I try to explain this the right way. When he goes all in, he's like me. You know, thank God he was like me. He had 7 days a week that he'd either be knocking doors for the church, or when it come time for baseball time, which a lot of times they played on Saturdays and Sundays. Therefore, he can't do either day of those because he's getting ready for sermons on Sundays. And then on Wednesday nights, you can't be there either. On Tuesday nights, you have visitation nights. On Thursday night, you have men's meeting nights. Every night is a deal that he could never ever be there. But what he did do was he came in and he checked on me every night. Every night he came in and checked on me every night before I went to bed. How'd you do tonight, son? How was tonight's game? Always checked on me.
Yeah, that was later
Curious.
in Ricky's life, though, because in the beginning, Ricky, tells a story about, how he gave you a choice, your will or God's will. And he was pretty tough on Ricky in his early years and would not accept the baseball. It was, as he felt, Ricky told me, it was false prophet, or it was a thing that was going to take him out of being faith, having his faith and pursuing what his father wanted, which is, preaching, right, Rick?
Yeah, exactly. And plus, he's afraid I was going to get hurt because I came off extensive surgeries young. And my legs were so messed up. And little did I know at the same time that it's involved in my spine too as well. I had a disease that I was born with that I inherited from my grandmothers. And at that time, when you're born in 56, I really don't like airing the year I was born. I really don't. I don't want to say I was born in 1956. I'd rather say that I'm on level six right now. But anyway, saying that, there's not much they could do. In fact, it came down to the fact, to the point that the braces got so expensive. But my dad, I think he built my last three or four sets of braces. He built them.
Wow.
He went and got what they looked like, got them and built them and made them himself.
Do you still wear braces?
No. Oh, no. No. No, I'm after those 8 years of misery, I took them off and I never looked back and I ran. I could run normal. You know, it worked. Basically, it worked. And I ran normal, other than I did snap my ankle later on in life during high school baseball. But yeah, I took the braces off, and once I took them off, that's all, they were off.
Jacqueline, that was one thing that I wanted to say on the field when he told me the story about hitting that sprinkler head with his foot, right when the scouts are in the stands ready to really give him a career. I couldn't believe it. I said, I've been on a million baseball fields. I've never seen a sprinkler head. And he's like, no, it really happened. And then I checked around and called people that owned fields. And they said, yeah, we have sprinkler heads out there that are flat. And every now and then they do pop up. And what happened to Rickey has happened to other people.
Yeah.
But that accident was bad enough on its own. But when they went and checked, this is what I got from the story that I researched. When he went into the hospital and they checked him, they found out he had degenerative spinal disease. And it was like already enough for him not to be able to try out. But then he found out that he had this degenerative spinal disease, and the hopes of playing were never going to happen for him. And, you know, one scene that's not in the movie that Rickey told me, it's kind of cute and interesting and sweet. It just wasn't in because we can't put the whole story in. It would be 10 hours long. But Rickey said that when he had his cast on, he went out to the field, just like we do in the movie, and he started hitting balls with his cast on and thinking about his degenerative spinal disease. And he saw some little boys playing, and he went over and said, you know, here's my bat. I'm quitting. That was the only time that Rickey ever thought about giving up. And everybody that was around him pushed him to go further. Ray, his family.
Rickey, what would you say to people who feel like giving up, who have physical or even mental or any type of limitation? What would you say to those people, and how can they keep their faith in God?
Well, I'll tell you this much. There's no such thing as giving up. You know, you might be lazy, but you don't give up. There's no such thing. You don't stop. The word quit, you've never heard of. You take those words, you throw them out of your vocabulary, and you tell yourself you're going to defeat whatever. You're going to defeat Goliath, basically. I would tell them that, look forward. There's an almighty God that can cure you. There's an almighty God right now that can cure your son. There's an almighty God that can do anything. That's why I use Philippians 4:13 as my life structure. And I just say this to any guy, if you know what, to go through what I've gone through, to have all the surgeries that I've been through, and I'm still where I am today, there's no quitting. It's living. And you face the fact that, guess what? You got to have faith. I've always said this. You know what? You fight the fight. You fight the fight. You keep the faith. And then you finish that course. And you finish your course. And don't ever quit it.
Jacqueline, that's kind of like Rickey and I were very much like that. It took me 17 years to get this movie made. And I just absolutely love this movie. We didn't stop, just like Rickey. Rickey told me that he told Red Murph he was the best hitter he's ever going to see, and I told him the same thing. And that's how we ended up getting together. And he stayed by my side this whole way. We're still friends today, very close friends. And the one thing I realized, though, you can tell everybody what a great movie it is, and you can talk about it, but when people see it like they're seeing it now and the word is catching on, and what it's doing to people's lives, that's a testament to what I went out to achieve. And the only way this movie is going to last, if people love it so much, is by buying tickets on opening weekend. What I didn't know, I'm a filmmaker, and I lived in Hollywood for years, and I never knew that when I'd go want to go see a movie, and I'd say, you know, right now, Susie and I, my wife, will go want to go see a movie, and we'll look for it, and all of a sudden it's gone. And I said, why is it gone? And then now I learned that if you don't buy tickets in advance for movies and fill those theaters the first weekend or the first week, they deem it not, you know, something they want to put more money to and push it out there. So if you guys buy tickets and really go out there and support the movie, it will become a sound of freedom, and it will last like Jesus Revolution did, or I Can Only Imagine. If you watch the movie and you feel it's worth it, after you watch it, tell everybody about it. And you can get tickets at thehillmove.com, thehillmov.com. It's also on Instagram, thehillmov. So think thehillmov.com. And you can get advance tickets now for the opening weekend and pack those houses so that we can, all these 17 years I did not go through to have a movie last a week. I wanted to be out there and touch people's lives like it did yours, Jacqueline, and just get out to the masses. I mean, I was at a screening last night with the Archdiocese of New York, and he asked me a question about the road that Rickey and I went on to get this made. And I broke down because I realized how much I put into this film and what it's doing to people. So we got to get the word out. That's the bottom line.
Were there any of the cast that was in, were they influenced by the movie? Any of the crew?
Yes.
Stories about that?
Yes, absolutely. Many, many. Dennis, in two scenes, broke down he and I both weren't expecting. He was very moved by this script from the day he ever read it. He said, man, this is an incredible story. I can't even believe it's true. And I proved to him it was. And then in the scene where he's going to punish his son, he was supposed to say a line and just tell his son to go back inside. And I'd worked on that line for months. And he said to me, I don't want to say this line. Why? You'll see it in my acting. You don't need the line. I said, you got to say the line. And then he broke down in the scene at the end of the scene and started crying. And I walked up, I said, are you okay? And he said, it's just my father just came rushing back into my body and I couldn't hold it, Jeff. I'm sorry. And I go, don't be apologized. That was amazing. And then he said, do you still need the line? You know, and I said, no, we're good. And then in the pulpit, when he confesses he's been not a great father to his congregation, he also broke down there. In the scene where he's going to punish his son, I looked around and some of the crew had tears in their eyes and were crying. And I went up to one of the grips, which are really strong, tough men, like construction workers that shape light for the film. That's their job. This guy was crying and the guy next to him. And I said, you okay? And he said, just reminded me of my dad, you know? So there's a lot of moments in this movie, I think, that I try to set out to touch everybody in a way they could all relate to it from their childhood.
See, you see, what Jeff just said, that scene kills me because I was there. I don't mean to do this. I'm sorry. Okay. But what he said just hit me pretty hard. Pretty hard. I was there and I witnessed him walk away from giving us a whipping because the man he was. I'm sorry, but I just had to let you know that's all real, and Dennis did it on his own. So I apologize. I've never done this before like this.
Okay, Rick. You know, the cast was just amazing, you know, talking about Dennis. Dennis was just the perfect person for play Ricky's father because Dennis has a well-rounded character. He's got morals. He's got values. He's got a huge heart. He's tough as nails when you want him to be. He's just 100% man. And we don't see that a lot today. You know, not that, you know, we don't have men today that are strong. It's just that back in the day we were just raised different. We didn't have computers. We didn't have phones. We didn't have all that. And we had to go out and work hard and raise a family close to heart because we were all, you know, in separate houses. We weren't all connected by social media. And it just, I think it built tougher character and better character in people. I noticed that when I go to these screenings with some of the Christian audiences, the kids come up to me and they're like, "Excuse me, sir, may I shake your hand?" I mean, they're so mannered, well-mannered and so respectful. And you don't see that today in some of the big cities with just kids that aren't, you know, have a family of faith, you know. It's so interesting. And so the whole cast, I think, just was magic. Every time I watch the movie, I still look at the cast and go, wow, I really feel like I'm watching a real family. Even myself, like I take myself out of the equation and I go, I'm just an audience member. And man, I really feel like these people are tied together.
I think the whole story is just completely providential, just everything about it. Especially, I mean, I was just, you know, replaying some of the stuff in my head, you know, when, and did this really happen? Like your dad, Rickey, lost his job. He got kicked out of the church. And then y'all got a flat tire on the way?
Yeah, we broke down immediately. We ran out of gas first. The car overheated. The tire blew out. All of this actually happened.
And the rain came. And in the real story, the whole family danced around the rain laughing. They thought it was funny. I couldn't do the dancing around the rain and the puddles because it was just too much. But I tried to recreate what really happened there. And this couple came up. In the movie, it's just the woman, but originally it was a couple. And they said, "You need a ride?" And that guy had a radio station that we didn't put in the movie either. And he took the pastor to the radio station, and the pastor got on the radio station and preached. And that's when his brother called and said, "Wait a minute, what about our church? We need a pastor." And that took them, you know, on another path. When he said, "I need a sign from God," it wasn't the flat tire and the rain. It was, you're getting all this for another reason, another chance. And that was the real story. I mean, the story's totally accurate and real, except for there's a couple little cute things that I changed a little bit. Same story, but just different told. Like the little rock in the windshield in the beginning, that Rickey hit it over a radio tower, not a windshield. We couldn't do that just doing the logistics and where we were. So I recreated the same feeling by him hitting a windshield. And that's how he met Ray. And in real life, that's how he met Ray. Ray saw him hitting these rocks in a field super far. And he went over and said, you're something special. You're a phenom. And you know, you're a prodigy. And that's how he met Ray. And Ray was very supportive of Rickey in his life and gave him a job at a scrapyard that Rickey and his brother both worked at, which is what I tried to depict in the movie with the mechanics and the old cars and stuff.
I learned that 2 days that day that I wanted to say this, that we broke down. I learned two things I'd never seen before. Number one, I'd never seen a color TV set, number one. And then number two, I had never had ice cream before.
Real?
Yeah, you think I wasn't jumping up and down for joy? As a little young boy, I just went, woo! I felt like I was already in heaven. I was just waiting on the Apostle Paul to come over and tell me, "Come over here, I want to introduce you to Jesus."
So I guess you eat ice cream all the time now.
I was going to say, no, you're addicted.
No, I don't because of, I don't want to be a pig. You know, I try to keep myself in shape.
But well, what's your favorite ice cream?
Believe it or not, it was it had everything in it. I can't think the name of it. Had everything in it. Well, of course, everyone loves orange sherbet. Everyone does. And that's still what that lady handed me that day was orange sherbet. And I'd never tasted anything like it. But boy, was it forever good. The problem was that I ate all of their all orange sherbet. I ate their whole gallon. They had 3 or 4 gallons. I ate the whole gallon of orange sherbet.
Jacqueline, you know, Angela Pizzo was our writer that wrote Rudy and Hoosiers. And when he wrote the script, he tried to put everything in it. And one of the scenes he took out of the 10 or 50 moments that aren't in the movie that I couldn't tell it would be a 5-hour movie was the hamburger scene that you saw. And he took it out because he said, I can't put everything in, Jeff. And I said, but that scene is why I wanted to make this movie. The fact that these kids went around saving all their pennies and for Christmas bought their father a hamburger and a Coke and some fries. And then he ended up cutting it up in 6 pieces for the family. But they didn't want it. They wanted him to have it. And that just ripped my heart out. And I had to make that. And I told Andrew, you got to put that back in. And he said, okay. But we got to take something else out now because it can't be super long. And so that's how that scene ended up in the movie.
That was beautiful. It was, I mean, there's so many scenes in the movie that just make you want to cry.
I just wish, honestly, I mean, I wish, Jacqueline, I wish that you could have been sitting at the table the night and witnessed it yourself, because I remember it like yesterday. I've never seen my father cry so much in my entire life. When he looked down and we had a hamburger for him, and he realized that we worked so hard. It took us 6 months to get a hamburger, Coke, and French fries, for us to find Coke bottles, put everything we could together. Us kids put everything we could together to get there. And when he looked down, he saw all that. He knew the work that was involved in it. And he bawled like a baby. And I'm so thankful that this family, what we had was love. And what is God about? Love. Love. And it was a moment that no one didn't really realize unless they were there seeing it. Because we all five were just bawling like babies. And just so thankful, you know, that God gave us enough to get that hamburger, the French fries, and that Coke. That was the world. It was 115 degrees outside. We didn't have AC. We didn't have a refrigerator. All we had was an ice box, and we handed them that burger. It was like I just handed him a whole bar of gold. That's what it was. It's just beautiful.
So, Jacqueline, do you have one last question for us?
Yeah. Is there anything, if you had one thing you wanted people to take from this film and this story, what would it be?
I've been asked that question many times, and I always answer it the same way because I know what that is. But I'm going to change that right now. Last night, well, this happened to me so many times, but last night it really hit me. I saw it with an audience who was very quiet, like on the edge of their seats, quiet. Still, I saw it with another audience before that. They were screaming the whole time and yelling and laughing and crying. But last night, this lady grabbed my hand and she squeezed it. And she said, kind of what happened with you and your son. She said, you changed my life. This movie is so inspiring. My life is in such a mess. And this movie just gave me hope and made me feel good for just short amount of time that it did in this movie. And I'm going to carry that with me. And if I can do that in this movie to everybody, that's why I made it. But I had no idea it was going to reach people like this. I just knew it was going to be a heartfelt film. I didn't want it to be schmaltzy or Hallmarky or any of those things. I tried to ride that line of an epic sweeping movie that would, you know, get into people's hearts. And what it did to that woman last night really surprises me every day. I never thought that I was going to make something so powerful that would, you know, change people in a way.
Rickey, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, you know, I really do. Now, this is somewhat of a Christian outlet, right?
Yeah, we're Catholic.
Okay, good. Okay. Well, that's even better. I would like to say this is when a person wants to give up all hope, that they have to remember this thing here, is there's always someone worse than you are. There always is. And then the last thing I would say this, that, and it's biblical, that I leave this message with most of the people that I talk to during the day, that I even today, I am really in the ministry today in a way, even though I help young ball players become better ball players. But Bible says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one makes it to the Father but through me.
You can't play baseball.
But I swing that bat. I ain't crippled no more.
Tag game, bottom of the ninth. At bat, Rickey Hill.
Oh my gosh! What did you do? Let's go!
Rickey, I've seen you out there swinging that stick, even when you're suffering pain. But you can't play baseball. You're gonna get ridiculed, and you're gonna wind up with an injury that you'll never get over. God's gonna give you a higher calling.
But all I wanna do is play. When I swing that bat, I ain't crippled no more.
And gone, senior Rickey Hill.
He did 4 homers in 1 game.
Son, you might be better, but you are not healed.
Your bones are rapidly depleting. It'll be a miracle if you ever walk again.
You seen this? Major league tryouts.
You're gonna paralyze him.
I don't need you filling him full of false hope.
He's my son.
Rickey, baseball had to end eventually. Time to figure out what you're gonna do with the rest of your life.
First time you ever talked to me like a man is to tell me to forget the only thing I ever loved.
What has gotten into you?
He's special.
They said he will never walk, and he ran. How many miracles do you need?
You're playing to join the elite.
I'm one of the best hitters you're ever going to see.
A bad leg could cost a team wins and money.
It's all stacked against me.
If you don't try, you're going to die inside. I want my dreamer back.
All your hopes.
I cannot do this alone.
Dreams.
It's your time, Rickey!
Determination and sacrifices have come down to this.